Welcome back to Chemistry Matters and our unit on the mole and stoichiometry. At the beginning of this unit, we examined how stoichiometry was the calculation of the quantities of reactants and products involved in a chemical reaction. In stoichiometric problems, you'll use a balanced chemical equation to help you calculate the amount of reactants needed for the reaction to occur, or the amount of product produced. These calculations are used every day in the manufacture of all types of household and industrial chemicals, from medicines, detergents, and polishes, to fuels, fertilizers, and plastics. Now that you have an understanding of how you can use dimensional analysis to solve problems that involve unit conversions, you're ready to use mathematics and computational thinking to tackle stoichiometric calculations. Since stoichiometry deals with chemical reactions, one thing that will always be required in order to perform stoichiometric calculations is a balanced equation. You learned how to balance chemical equations in Unit 5, and the reason it'll be imperative to use a balanced equation is that proportional relationships are communicated by the coefficients in a balanced equation. For example, take the following reaction. 2 moles of magnesium react with 1 mole of oxygen to produce 2 moles of magnesium oxide. There are several relationships that I could observe by just looking at these coefficients, which are often called mole ratios. A mole ratio is the ratio of moles of one substance to the moles of another substance in a balanced equation. For instance, I can look at this reaction and say, for every 2 moles of magnesium that react, 2 moles of magnesium oxide are produced. I can also say that for every 2 moles of magnesium that react, 1 mole of oxygen is required. Remember from Unit 5, if there's not a coefficient, it's understood that there's one of that substance. Finally, I know from the formula that for every 1 mole of oxygen that reacts, there'll be 2 moles of magnesium oxide produced. It's these proportional relationships, these mole ratios, that are at the very heart of every stoichiometry calculation ever performed. You see, mole ratios function as conversion factors for us when we do stoichiometric conversions. In that regard, they're analogous to equivalence statements that we used earlier in this unit. Remember how we said 1 dozen equals 12, and that we could write that statement as a conversion factor with either 1 dozen over 12 or 12 over 1 dozen? The conversion factor we chose just depended on what we were given to start with in terms of the units in the problem. It's exactly the same thing here with mole ratios and stoichiometry. Just as we had to be systematic before when we were doing conversions, we need to be systematic when we approach stoichiometry calculations. So let's look at steps required when performing a stoichiometric calculation. When starting a stoichiometric calculation, always first write a balanced equation, or at least verify the one we are given is in fact balanced. Step 2. We need to identify what is given to us in the problem, units included, as well as what you're asked to solve for. Step 3. Start a conversion chart with the number and unit that's given to us in the upper left-hand corner. There are several choices, so let the units guide the conversion. If converting between moles and grams, use molar mass. If converting between moles and liters of solution, use molarity. If converting between moles and liters of gas at STP, use molar volume. Next, we'll always have a mole ratio step in every single stoichiometry problem that we do. So step 4 is to use mole ratio to convert from moles of the substance given to moles of the substance needed. This is a core step in all stoichiometry problems. This mole ratio is always determined from the coefficients in the balanced equation. Finally, do the math by multiplying all values in the numerator and dividing by the product of all values in the denominator, and check your answer. Let's do a couple of practice problems, and I think you'll see this is very similar to the calculations you've done previously in this unit. Chemicals such as potassium chlorate, potassium perchlorate, sodium chlorate, and barium peroxide all contain oxygen and can be used to generate oxygen gas for emergency oxygen systems aboard aircraft and submarines. This first problem asks, how many moles of potassium chlorate, KClO3, must decompose in order to produce 9 moles of oxygen gas? The first thing we should check is if the equation is balanced, and it is. There are 2 potassiums, 2 chlorines, and 6 oxygens on both sides of the equation. The next step is to determine what is given to me and what it is I need to solve for. 9 moles of oxygen is the starting point in this problem, since that's what's given. I need to determine how many moles of potassium chlorate, the reactant, will react to produce 9 moles of oxygen in order to solve the problem. So I place 9 moles of oxygen in the upper left-hand corner of a conversion chart. Then I bring down the units of moles of oxygen to the denominator in the second column. Next, I have to determine what the conversion factor is for this step. Since I know the number of moles given to me in the problem in the denominator, I know this step will be the mole ratio step, which is the step that allows me to convert from moles of the substance I started with in the problem to moles of the substance I'm trying to solve for, in this case, potassium chlorate. I'll write the coefficients for potassium chlorate and oxygen gas from the balanced equation into the conversion chart to complete the mole ratio step. Since this question requested that we solve for moles of potassium chlorate, we're done converting. So all we have to do is cancel the units and do the math. 9 times 2 is 18, and 18 divided by 3 is 6. Notice that moles of O2 cancels out with moles of O2, leaving units for the answer as moles of KClO3. So 6 moles of potassium chlorate are required, according to this reaction, if I want to produce 9 moles of oxygen. These types of stoichiometry calculations are usually considered the easiest, as there are very few steps involved. They're called mole-to-mole conversions because, as you can see, we were presented with moles of one substance in the reaction, and we were asked to convert to moles of another substance in the reaction. More complex stoichiometry problems can involve what are known as mass-to-mass stoichiometric calculations. In a mass-to-mass stoichiometry problem, we're given the mass of one substance in a chemical reaction and asked to convert to the mass of another substance in the problem. There are multiple steps involved, but if you'll just be systematic and let the units guide the conversion, you'll always find the right answer. Here's an example of a mass-to-mass problem. Silver nitrate can be used in electroplating jewelry or in the manufacture of high-quality silver mirrors. How many grams of silver will be formed from the reaction of 12.0 grams of copper with silver nitrate according to this reaction? We already have a balanced equation. And in this problem, we're given the mass of copper that's going to be used in the reaction. And the problem asks us to solve for the amount of silver that will be produced in grams. So we'll place 12.0 grams of copper in the upper left-hand corner of the conversion chart, since that information was given to me. Then we'll let the units guide the conversion by bringing down grams of copper to the denominator of the next column. Here's where we have to determine my first conversion factor. We can't go straight from grams of copper to grams of silver, because there's no such thing as a gram ratio. But if we can convert the grams of copper into moles of copper first, then we can take advantage of the fact that the coefficients in the balanced equation can be used to relate the copper and silver in terms of moles. So we'll use the molar mass of copper from the periodic table to convert from grams of copper to moles of copper. 1 mole of copper has a mass of 63.55 grams. You can see this conversion factor written into the conversion chart. Once we have moles of the substance that the problem gave us information about, copper, we can then use the mole ratio step to convert to moles of the substance we're seeking from the problem. In this question, silver. Remember, these numbers come from the coefficients in the balanced equation. 1, understood for copper, and 2, for silver. And don't forget to cancel the units as you proceed through the calculation. Since this question asked for grams of silver as opposed to moles, we must continue with the conversion. So if we bring the units of moles of silver down to the denominator of the next column, we can use the molar mass of silver as a final conversion factor. 1 mole of silver has a mass of 107.87 grams. This conversion factor allows us to convert from moles of silver to grams of silver. Since this is the unit that the question asked for originally, then I finished the converting step of the problem. All that's left is to multiply all the numbers across that are found in the numerator, 12.0 times 1 times 2 times 107.87 equals 2,588.88. Then we divide that by the product of 63.55 times 1 times 1, which is 63.55. Finally, divide 2,588.88 by 63.55 to get 40.7 grams. This is how we know that 40.7 grams of silver are made if 12.0 grams of copper are used, according to this reaction. Stoichiometric calculations such as these have to be performed every day by chemists in various fields, such as industrial, pharmaceutical, and environmental chemistry. We've also placed a graphic organizer showing the relationship between all types of stoichiometric calculations in the Chemistry Matters Toolkit. You should draw a graphic organizer like this one to help you organize your thinking when performing these calculations. You're welcome to use the template provided for you in the Chemistry Matters Toolkit. When you're finished, join us back here, where we'll investigate how to predict the amount of a chemical product you can make.